Kickwalk.
Yeah.
That was you?
Maybe tomorrow.
I used that years ago. No, I used it years ago when I was running.
Oh, good, yes.
Awesome.
Morning, Greg. How are you?
How are you?
Good.
Are you
just or
no?
Yeah, right now.
Yeah, so the same place here. They always have a problem.
Oh, you're Craig. How do we?
Nice to meet you.
I need to do is make it impossible to acquire, so that it seems like you want to keep fraud and markdown back to bad.
That's not supposed to happen. It's like,
I want to do that. Very much so.
Exactly.
Yes, because on the screen it certainly is. Wait, going to be looking
at? That's just Google. It mirrors it for you locally, but not for everyone else.
Okay. Oh, why does it do that?
Because apparently people are used to seeing mirrors, and so for you they mirror it, which is stupid, but...
Oh, okay, but...
Perfect, then...
Then had no problem with it?
Huh?
They had no problem with it?
Yeah, they can hear it.
Okay,
so.
Great.
And I won't do that again, but the office is at least not close to that.
Good morning, Racketeers!
Good morning.
All right.
Good morning, and welcome to fourth of RacketCon. So before we begin the actual program, which is packed full of awesome speakers, I just have a few things that I'd like to tell you. So first, I'd like to thank our sponsors, thanks to them, we can be here today. So first, I'd like to thank Matthew Butterick, who is here in the audience, thanks to whom we have Wi-Fi today.
All right.
Yeah.
And I would also like to thank the Northeastern University Student ACM Chapter, who has been lending us, who has lent us their video equipment, thanks to which we have a live stream on Google Hangout, and we are recording videos that we will be putting online shortly after the conference. So thank you to the Northeastern ACM Chapter. So a few technical points. If you need to connect to the Wi-Fi, the ESSID is double tree meeting. You shouldn't need any password or anything. There's a splash screen that you need to go through, but everything should work. If it doesn't, let me know and we'll figure it out. The schedule, if you'd like to see it, is on con.racketlang.org. If you'd like to participate on discussion on IRC, please go to the Hash Racket channel on Freenode, where some people are following at home along with us. And if you'd like to provide commentary, witty comments, or anything really, the hashtag to use today is #RacketCon on Twitter. And one last thing before we go on to our keynote. So you may have noticed that we've been using, you know, fourth RacketCon as a title for this conference. And so this is, you know, an actual real-life piece of racket code. So what happens if you type that at the record? Any takers? Exactly. I think you can tell who wrote that error message. It's recited from memory. So this is a bit of a problem, because, I mean, RacketCon, that's why we're here today. We want it to be defined. And so we can define it, for instance, to be a list of standard fishes, for instance, and in which case we have, you know, the error message goes away and we get something nice. But I think some of you may have better ideas as to what RacketCon should be. And so today we're going to have a contest. And tweet your favorite definition for RacketCon with the hashtag RacketContest. And at the end of the day, the definition that gets the most retweets and favorites will win. A free copy of Realm of Racket, autographed by Matthias Valaisen. So don't forget, what?
And Spencer.
Yes, that's right, and Spencer, and all the authors will also be signing it as well. So don't forget to submit your definitions, and don't forget to retweet and favorite to vote for your favorite definition. So that's all I had to say today. So now I'd like to invite our keynote speaker today, Fogus. So it is my great pleasure to introduce Fogus, who is a developer of Clojure, the atomic Clojure script transit as well, right? Yes, and who is the author of The Joy of Clojure, Functional JavaScript, and the upcoming release, which I'm really looking forward to, The Art of Chupacabra Husbandry. So, without further ado, folks.
Commit that to memory. There we go. Okay. So, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm Michael Fogus. I'm not sure exactly why I was invited here, although I might have some ideas. I mean, I once read a book on Racket that might have something to do with it. It was a very good book, by the way, but I've written a book, two books actually, and have my own blog. All of these things are important in the modern day. You know, if you're not online, you don't really exist. I have a little newsletter that I've written. I contributed to Clojure script and Clojure, and I even wrote a language once that was inspired by Racket. And all of these things have a common denominator, I think, and it really answers why I was probably invited here. I think I can safely say that I am some kind of thunk leader. and as a thunk leader, I think it's my duty to say something very inspiring that is confusing at the same time, and you might not realize what the meaning until later. So the story that I have to say, the inspirational story I have to say, like all good stories, starts with a goose. And so, There was a master macrologist named Pai Mu, and he had a he he had a zendo where he would teach students the art of necrology. And one day a student came to him and he presented him with a problem. He said, "My Mu, there is a goose." And one day an acolyte put the goose in a bottle, a Klein bottle indeed. And he loved the way that the goose was always warm and it was able to be fed through the bottom and turned over, the goose would fall over, the food would come down on top of its head, but it was still able to be fed. But the goose would grow and grow and grow, and it was becoming quite uncomfortable here. And the student said, "How does one extract a goose from a Klein bottle?" And so Pai Mu looked at him and immediately changed the subject to the weather and talked about it. How nice it is to walk around the woods, and eventually the student forgot that he'd even asked. And so as the student left, he was about to leave, and Pai Mu said, "Oh, just a moment." And the student turned around, he said, "There, it's out." So keeping that in mind. You know, we live in a time where there are just, I'd say, hundreds and hundreds of blog posts, informational sources, coming to terms with a very simple concept, this. And if you're not sure what I mean by that, there's an idea in JavaScript that these objects have this reference that refers to an object. And so in JavaScript, it's very difficult to understand at any given moment what the value of this is. And so it's disheartening to me to know that there are languages like Racket that don't have these kinds of problems, and indeed are quite heavenly in the way that they are constructed and they're used. And it's quite a shame to me that we're in this situation. But one time I was in Bologna and I went to a little church and it was a church that Dante had visited. And so they had a lot of murals and you know, heaven and hell. And so this is not one of the murals that was there, this is very representative of the kind of mural. And I say, you know, this is Racket, and you know, there's a lot of nice things to look at. But then I looked at the images of hell, and I think I understood why we're sort of in this situation. And the reason is, I think, because honestly, hell looks like a lot more fun. there's a lot more going on, I have to say. So I'm sure there's a lot more to it than that, but I think that this is maybe. We can start from this as the premise. Now, at one point, I had this great idea about writing a book, and I was going to pick a programming language and sort of dive into the programming language's influence. And the language that I had picked was Ruby, for whatever reason. I don't even know why, but I think it has a rich history of languages that directly influence it. But when I presented this idea to one of my friends and colleagues, Russell's, his response was immediately, "Oh, don't do that. No one cares about this." Now, I wondered why he would say something like that, and it led me to really examine why what I thought would be an extremely interesting book would be outright dismissed like that. And I think part of it has to do with something like this smells of PLT. Now, PLT nowadays is a dirty word for people who may actually be doing something that represents or something that resembles what PLT might be, and for those who, you know, maybe take it as a joke. And it seems to have taken on it seems to have inspired a lot of joke. You know, there's just an endless stream of PLT this and PLT that, just making jokes about. And then this is honestly my favorite one. I do find it quite funny. More than that, I think that, you know, that there's this view in the industry I want to say, and I want to make that word, see, I use that word very specifically in the industry, that programming languages are sort of very isolated things. You know, they sort of all stand on their own, and there's this, you know, these guys over here and these guys over here, and there's this constant tension, and someone must win. And in reality, I don't think that's true at all. I think that there's a connectedness between all of the languages, and if you look at it in a really high in the sky kind of way, all languages are the same. I certainly don't mean that in a sort of fake Turing equivalence argument. I mean that in that languages, for better or for worse, influence each other, and there's sort of this patterning in language development that languages without the influences of any other language would be very different. What would closure be like? I mean, would there even be a closure if there wasn't a Java, if there wasn't a C++? It certainly I would imagine it would be very different. So keeping that in mind, I think that, you know, there's this tension in industry and in the world that Racket lives in, that I'd like to address. But to do that, I'd like to start with what I think is Racket, one of Racket's greatest strengths, and that's education. I think that I personally cannot think of a better language for the purposes of educating young computer scientists, and never mind computer scientists, but anyone who might be interested in learning this the programming skill. Now, you know, this only touches on a few things, but if you look at the world of Racket and you explore its richness, there's so much. There's too much, honestly, to get through in the amount of time that many people have to explore these kinds of things, especially in industry. But there's so much there, and I think that we sort of have to use Racket in an educational context to foster all of these ideas. But in academia, and certainly I'm looking at this from an outsider's perspective, so please take what I say with a grain of salt. We kind of are in a situation where we have paper after paper after interminably dull paper, sort of, that is proof begets proof begets proof begets paper begets paper. And it's sort of like academia by mitosis. And so from an outsider's perspective looking in on that, it's very, it can be very intimidating, I would say, especially given that the current environment in academic publishing is such that it fosters that kind of the production of that kind of paper. And so one thing I'd like to say is that we have to be very careful about assigning a value judgment to based on the current trend in what it takes to get an academic paper published. I think from an outsider's perspective, that seems to be happening. But the good news is that every Racket paper, or most Racket papers I've read, and I've read my share, it tends to be very playful. Racket papers, indeed. I've yet to read a dull Racket paper, and I think that's important, because the notion of playfulness, I think, is actually very important in programming. When I was in school, I was a TA, and some of my favorite students were those who came in and sort of had a playful attitude towards learning, towards programming, and I think that really shines through in Racket. Now, there is a downside to that, I think, because in the pre-college education, especially in the United States, the technical bent is is actually quite weak, I would say. And students come in not knowing very little, and especially knowing very little about how to learn. And so it's a very challenging environment for professors to have students who come in and don't really have a context for programming, and certainly not a context for learning in general. But if you can find the student who's playful, I think that that's a good thing. But very often, the students come in and they don't really know how to, they don't know how to learn. And so very often they were in undergrad. They were in high school, and they worked on the computer alone, and they hacked away on the weekends, and they have a very poor understanding of what it takes to be prepared to write programs and to think. And so when they get to college, I think that it's important, at least in the United States, I've found that it's important to somewhat like salted meat, to spoil them in a way, to make them tolerable to live with. And what I mean by that is that the student the student left to their own devices is could be a dangerous thing, as I say, dangerous to themselves. And so I think it's important to know that we shouldn't make the student feel like they're on probation. You know, it's important to teach them certain principles. They can take that along with them. And I think it requires a language that's slightly different. And I think that Racket is indeed that language. Not only because it's an interesting language, but I think that it's important to expose the student to something that's different and provides different ways of solving problems and thinking. Different paradigms, because we're kind of in a pickle where we are programming languages, and the people who are practicing them tend to see the problems through a very narrow scope. When I was a kid, I was a skateboarder, and so we would build ramps, and very often all we had was a hammer. And so how do you build a ramp out of a hammer? It's actually quite challenging, but it can be done. So you take the claw and you score the wood deeply, and you sort of put it on the edge of the curb and you smash it. You smash the wood until it's somewhat straight, and then you nail it all together. And you've built this ramp out of a hammer. And so that to me is sort of modern programming. The approach to programming, and you can say, there's a one of my favorite sayings is that, when you have C++, every problem starts to look like your thumb. I'm not a hater. So, but I think that there's this sort of leads back to problem in our very way of looking at the world, and human intelligence is such that most of the time we see things in a very focused view. We're focusing on one thing. Even the way that we see is in a very focused way. We can move from one place to another, but I think that doesn't really solve the problem. So if we have a certain way of thinking about things, we tend to drill down in our brains are somewhat fighting it with us to do that. But there's a different kind of intelligence, I think, that one where I would call it setting the pot to boil. And that's the kind of intelligence where you take some ideas that you've come up with and you sort of put them in the back of your brain. And you go off and you do your things, and one day you wake up and I've got it. But the problem is that way of doing things is somewhat like holography, where you can take
a tiny portion of an image and reconstruct the image from a fragment of that piece. And so the smaller piece, you can take the tiniest fragment and reconstruct the image, of course, where you have that, where the tiny piece that you started with is very clear, but then on the edges it gets much more blurry. And so it's important to start with a larger piece to, if you want to properly reconstruct the image that you started with. Now, that's where Racket comes in, I believe. A language like Racket, especially, is that in order to set the pot to boil, to make a good cup of tea, for example, you have to start with good water, you have to start with good tea leaves, or else you're running into some big problems. And Bodo, I know you missed the phone. Please notice the pony. I was told yesterday that you must have ponies. And this one spits, so I had to add my own bent to it. So yeah, I mean, I think, you know, if you're setting the pot to boil, you have to have good ingredients if you want to make a good soup. And a language like Racket can do that. So what are some of the things that we can learn, we can teach, that Racket fosters, that would allow us to make thinkers who are able to solve those hard problems in a way that is not constrained to thinking in a very narrow view? I think one of the ways is a Racket approach to languages. And there's a couple quotes I'd like to share, both from the foreword of my book, Joy of Closure, that was written by Friedman and Bird. And the first is by Alan Perlis, and he says, "There will always be things that we wish to say in our programs that all known languages can only be said poorly." I think that's, it's Perlis. I mean, this is what he did. He was able to succinctly state things that, on the surface, seem so obvious, but we have real trouble falling into these problems. But another way of putting a similar notion was mentioned by the two authors of the foreword, and it says, "Creating little languages to solve a specific problem is the most effective technique yet devised for reducing complexity and suffering." Now, I suspect that that's a debatable statement, but I think that the nature of it is spot on. I think that some of the, if you're writing a programming language to solve a problem, the very best language to use to solve that problem is the one that directly expresses the solution in a way that is coherent within the domain that the problem lies. And in Racket, I think we have a great capability for doing this, multiple capabilities for doing this, but the one that really stands out for me is the pound line capability. So this is Spider Dog. I suggest you look this up immediately. I mean, do it now if you want. I won't. I'm totally. It's an amazing YouTube video. But in any case, almost as amazing as Spider Dog is the way that you can take this Lang capability and turn the Racket language on its head. I don't know how to better explain it, but it's the kind of thing that if you look into deeply, it'll blow your mind and it'll stay blown. Because this is some amazing capability. And even more so than this, it sort of fosters a new way of thinking about languages, I would say, and programming in general. And I read a paper, many papers by Ian Quiamarta, and he talks about something called mood-specific languages, and that's where you take the idea of you have contextual blocks, and you express within that block exactly the right language to solve that particular problem. And I think this is a very powerful idea that in industry, we're certainly not using with any proficiency. And I think that perhaps there is a room for it. Another way that we can use Racket to foster good thinking
is building up systems based on core solid principles. And so, you know, Racket itself is designed in this way. I think if you look at the work that's been done with submodules and the language itself informed the way that that should be created. And there's a book that I've only read partially. It's a very big book. It's called Living Systems. And although it's not about programming computer systems, I think it has a lot to say about this approach. And just like in the development of the submodules, the Racket had something to say about the way that should be done, and the Racket implementers listened very closely. And I think I would say that it was a success, as far as I can understand the way that it was solved. So this is another way, I think, that I know that we, my company, myself, Rich is in the audience, and this is certainly something that we've taken to heart, in that the language that we're using should inform the way that we're building our systems. And this is something that I see as a real problem in industry, especially where things tend to try to be shoved into a certain way of doing things rather than having the system problem and the very core concepts inform the rest of the development. So I'd like to present an idea, you know, how this all fits together. And so if we have a problem, often we start with not a really good understanding of what's going on. We have no idea what we're looking at. You know, we're looking at the letter O, but that's really, I'm just using that to represent object-oriented programming. So this is object-oriented programming. We're trying to solve a problem. We have no idea what it is. Now, object-oriented programming is going to inform our thinking and the way that we go about solving this problem. And it may give us a partial view of the way that we can get at the solution. But even still, we don't quite know what's going on. We need more. Now maybe we can take logic programming and add that to our arsenal. And now we may have a better idea of exactly how we can solve our problems. But even still, unless you have a context for what this picture is, you might not still know what you're looking at. So again, we need to really branch out and think about things from other perspectives. And so even still, we may actually get a more crystalline, clear view of the picture. But there's more to learn. There's more to use. There's more that we need to put at our disposal for building systems and solving problems. And I think that at its very core, Racket is an embodiment of that sort of ideal. So, you know, in case you're wondering, this is what we're trying to look at. But we may never get at this clarity in trying to solve a problem. But when building up and educating people, we need to be able to give them the way of removing the occlusion from their views as soon as possible. And I think that Racket is that kind of language. But the problem is, I think, that Racket is not widely adopted in education as I would like it to be, and I'm sure as everyone here would like. In fact, there was a trend at least a few years ago to sort of focus on more industry-specific, something that a student can take with them as soon as they graduate and get the ground running. But I think that a language like Java is insufficient for that because, as I mentioned before, a student is like that consultant. They come in and they're spoiled a bit in education just so they don't rot, and eventually they must be rehydrated. They must be made to be thinkers. And I'm not sure that focusing on a language like Java at an early stage like that is going to do it. So I'd love to see, though I think that Racket's true strength is in education, I would love to see it really take off. Now,
that's up to many people in this room to solve that problem. I don't have the answers to that. But I do have something to say about industry. So really, you know, what we would love to see, you know, there are always surveys. You know, what's the language, what's the most popular language? Never mind the specious way in which they would come to these conclusions. But it would be great one day if it looked like this, right? this would be awesome. Even this would be awesome for me, but you know we live in the real world, and when I say real world, I often do this because you know my subjective real world is very different from someone else's. And when I was writing the first edition of Joy Closure, there were many complaints. You got to put real world examples in there. So I elicited feedback. What would be a real world example? Well, web stuff. You got to have web stuff and like how to do forms. And like, okay. Well, when I go to work, I don't do any of that stuff. I'm writing distributed simulations, and you know this. I've never needed a form. I've never needed to process custom data. So I wanted to. It kind of reminds me of the story about Picasso, and he was living in France during World War II. And when France was liberated, he was visited by a young GI. And the GI came up to him and said, "You know, I just don't get your paintings. They don't look like the real world." And so Picasso said, "Oh, that's interesting." And he changed the subject. And he said, do you have a girlfriend?" And he said, "Of course I do." And said, "Do you have a picture?" And he said, "Yes, of course I do." So he took a picture out of his wallet. Picasso looked at it and she said, "Oh, is she so small as all this?" And so, you know, when I say real world, the quotes are, please understand. So, you know, in the real world, you know, things look more like this. Right? This is closer to reality. I mean, there's closures over here. It's got a little tiny sliver, and there's like a pixel wide bluish strip for Racket. I think that's fairly representative, although maybe not entirely accurate. Although I would suggest that it may be just as accurate as observing. So, but if you'll notice, you know, closure sort of found this adoption that while seems very small. I'm of the opinion that it's sort of hit, it's achieved a level where I may be able to spend an entire career working with closure and using closure. And so, but that wasn't the case, 6 or 7 years ago when I first learned of closure. And Racket, was it Racket 6 or 7 years ago? Was it still PLT scheme? It was PLT scheme. There were three options that I came to, and there was PLT scheme, and there was Racket, and now this new thing called Closure. At the time, I think it was called Lisp number 6433. and so, when coming to a decision of why I would have chosen Closure over something like PLT scheme, or Qi at that time, it's now called Shen. I think that there are a few things that I used in my thought process that may be emblematic of the way that other people are using. And the three that really stand out is that it immediately came with a rich set of persistent immutable data structures. I think that was really kind of, at the time, it was a new way of doing things, and that was interesting, of course. But the benefit that provided was fairly obvious as from my perspective as a Java programmer having to struggle with a lot of problems that Java programmers are struggling with at the time. But because I was a Java programmer, I mean, the Java interop was obviously a big win for me. And when I first discovered Closure, I was working in a SCIF, and a SCIF, for lack of a better definition, is an environment that is very closed down and very restrictive in what you can do, kinds of computing resources you can bring, network connections out. And certainly for me, getting Dr. Skeen into that kind of environment was just a no-go. Installing Common Lisp to run Qi was just not going to happen. But when we enumerated the list of dependencies for the system we were building, Clojure.jar was an easy inclusion. And so getting that into the kind of environment that I was able to work in was easy and at the time, because of these other events, but you know, before polymorphism, I'm not sure that there is an answer for that yet. Although I'm not up to speed with the current research, but I would say that Clojure's story for that is very strong, and it achieves that by delegating down to its host environment. But that's not to say that Racket can't make inroads here. I think that in recent years we're in a renaissance of programming, not only in academia, but also in, I won't speak for academia, but I will say so in industry. And I think that this environment that we find ourselves in is a real opportunity for Racket to make some inroads. There's no reason in a system that's built up of services on the back end server, there's no reason that Racket can't serve as one of those services on the back end. I mean, Paul Graham talked about that a long time ago, but I don't think that you know, if we think back about how this polyglot, this language renaissance came about, and especially in the way that it allowed a language like Clojure to gain a modest amount of success, I would say, is that you know, there was a reemergence, and I don't know, I can't say for sure if Racket has benefited from this, but it certainly wasn't in the, this reemergence didn't come about because of, say, Common Lisp or Paul Graham's writings, although I suspect he may have had a little bit to do with it. But really, I think that there's two reasons why this came about. One of them is Ruby, and one of them is Python. And those two languages, and I'd like to say thank you for this, those two languages really, I think, opened up people's minds to the possibilities. Now, these languages were informed somewhat by Lisp, but they had their own problems, and obviously, if you're a Ruby programmer or a Python programmer, and you see the power of some of these ideas, it's only natural to want more. So I'd like to say that it's a good thing that this happened, because it's allowed a language like Clojure to gain some traction, and it will allow a language like Racket to do so. Same. Because like I said, you know, it's not enough to know one or two paradigms. We need to know more, because that allows us, when solving any kind of problem, to triangulate. If we can't do that, then I question the value of the systems that we're creating. But the problem is we're working in an environment that people are working off of unexamined suppositions. They really need to think about the languages that they're using, the tools that they're doing, the preconceived notions that they bring to any problem informed by these languages. And I think that Racket, more so than a language, can serve as a lens for viewing computation. So it's very nice. I love Racket. It's a beautiful language. But the ideas in Racket, I think, are more important than Racket itself. And I would say the same about Clojure. You know, the way that Racket approaches solving problems, including the problems in the language itself, is very informative. And I hope, and I think that there's an opportunity that we can use to inform industry. Because if without that kind of lens, how do you know? How do you know when something's good? You can't triangulate based off multiple points of view. Then I'm not sure that you can come to good solutions. So how do we get Racket to? How does Racket achieve this? How do we get Racket into the minds, and better yet, under the fingers of people who are using it for building systems in the industry. So what Racket needs is reach, right? We need to be able to get it. And there's a few ways you can do it. And one way, obviously, is to sort of ride on the coattails of a language that already has reach. And Closure script has done that. And I believe that there's an effort in Racket called Whale Song. Is that right? Whale Song that is targeting this kind of reach. And so targeting a language that people already have accessibility to, even the people that may be in those black holes of the skiff, is something that I think can be very powerful. But that's not the only way. I mean, this is definitely, I would say, maybe the most powerful way, but there are other ways that Racket can sort of infiltrate industry. And one way that I absolutely know is the case is that it's influencing languages and libraries that are already being used in industry. And so I created a library called Core Contracts that, although doesn't follow the exact dictums of Racket's contracts capability, and in fact it absolutely cannot follow the exact dictums of Racket, because Racket, I think they would, you guys would like me to think that it's just all macros, right? There are hooks in the language that they were taking advantage of. And Matthias put me onto this. And but it explains a lot and why I couldn't get the same level capability. But if you look at it, you may actually see the influence there. So you know we have a couple functions that are defined. Later on, we apply some contracts. One is to the deposit for the argument A. You know that function should take a number and return something. And likewise for the balance function, no arguments. We don't really care what it takes, but it should return a number. And so you know this will construct a function that will give some level of safety. Not as much as I would say that you would get achieved in Racket. But it was highly informative. And this has been used in some projects that are now being deployed to the real world. But more important, and I think with a lot more, something a lot more important than that, I think, and more deeply used, and it's gathered the attention of people in industry, is core typed, and Ambrose talked about this at Strangely. And it's a wonderful system, and it is absolutely informed by type scheme and typed Racket. And Ambrose would be the first to fall all over himself to explain that to anyone. But so I won't go into this a lot because he already talked about it, but you know, you're annotating a function with some types and you're checking them after the fact. So while it's certainly not exactly like type scheme, I think that's type Racket, excuse me. It's certainly that's his model for building up this thing that I think a lot of people are really interested in getting their hands on. So that's a couple of ways. You know, we can I would say influence, although some people may say theft, but Racket certainly has influenced people. In the way that they're building systems, and especially Closure, I would say this is only a small thing. Closure libraries, and I'll leave it to Rich to say how it may have influenced Closure language. But the other way is certainly via employment. So on the Rust team, there are numerous people working on that team that. We're educated, influenced deeply by Racket, and especially its macro system, and Rust's macro system, to the extent that I can understand it, is indeed influenced by Racket, the pattern matching, the hygiene. It's a stunning system, I would say. And these guys, among others, I would say, have a lot to say about that. Along this vein, there are other ways that Racket are indeed influencing industry, And of course, Sam sitting over there has helped out with Mozilla, has gone to Mozilla and had something to say about the way that the module systems are built. And Herman, of course, that name pops up here, and you'll see his name a lot if you follow this trail. And Matthew, of course, is his work on Honu, who was instrumental in the way the suite of JS was. And these are things that are actually widespread, garnering a lot of excitement in the industry. But the problem is, you know, this is not enough. Racket influencing these languages is great. I think this is really very important. But what we would like to see is people actually using Racket, because there's a lot of programmers out there who are just hungry for something else. And it's not enough to eat a paycheck. They're really hungry for something more. And I'm going to use a term that maybe some of you will not necessarily like, but I'm going to use it to sort of stand in for the idea of someone out there who is not aware of Racket education, and is not using it. So this is the stand-in thing I'm going to use. But they're hungry, someone who's really hungry. And so to do that, I'd like to ask a question. Raise your hand if you've ever had an idea. A lot of people. Keep your hands up. I want to ask if, now put your hand down, keep it up. You can keep your hand up. I know I'm sure you've had ideas. So there's a certain kind of idea that I want to ask. The kind of idea that I'm really getting, the kind that something is really just nagging at you. And if you're like me, maybe working at your desk and have your headphones in, this kind of music playing, the kind of music we heard yesterday. It's that kind of driving beat, right? And so you're sitting there, and all of a sudden something comes to you, right? And you stop. Everything stops. And you look down, and you're looking at no point in particular. You can put your hands down. Go ahead. And you have no point in particular. I'll ask you to raise them again. Looking at no point in particular, then the music is thrumming in your ears, and you see this like these colors, kind of the edge of your vision, and it's like red and yellow and blue, and it's sort of focusing in on it. And you can't stop it because you don't want to lose it. And you know that there's something there, and sort of your vision blurs a bit, and it becomes blackness, but not like true black, but blacker and see through. And patterns emerge in this lacquer. You know that you're onto a really good idea, and it's coming. And you can see within these patterns that they're composed of smaller patterns, and you don't want to even breathe because you're going to lose it. And all of a sudden, this flash, and the doors of the mind are just blown apart, and now you just get it. You get it. And you realize that you're sitting there, and all that's left is an empty buffer. You're ready. I'm ready to do it. So don't raise your hand if you have that kind of thing. Okay. So good. So that's the empty buffer. I mean, that's the domain of the autodidact, right? And this is where we live, right? We're doing this over and over again. We're presented with this view all the time. And I'd say, you know, the autodidact, you know, they're constantly trying to learn, and they're looking, they're hungry, they're seeking, and they're really trying to make something better of themselves, and trying to expand their minds, and the kind of thing that they're looking for is exactly found in Racket. And for someone like that to discover something new and come to this idea and come to a language and sort of launch it for the first time, just type something really simple, it's really just a magical thing. This should return 3. That's awesome, right? And that's really a magical thing. And it's, although it's even more interesting if it doesn't return 3. But in any case, this is where those guys live. And they're working, right? And they're going to work every day. It's the same thing. They're doing the same thing every day. It doesn't seem like there's anything new happening. They're seeking. And they come to this new idea, they come to these languages. And in closure, I saw this happen over and over again. There were many people that were just coming to the language because they were excited by the possibility. And they saw that there was this blank slate and that they could contribute something, they could do something special within this language. And they were ready. They wanted to change themselves and wanted to change their industry by making themselves a different person. And so, you know, the patron saint of the autodidact is Aldous Huxley. He had a lot to say about this kind of thinking. And I'll let you go off and seek that. But there's one thing in Racket, there was one thing about Racket, one small thing about Racket that sort of prohibits this kind of excited entry. And that small thing is that Racket is just there. There's this mountain of stuff. And there's no, from an outsider's perspective, it seems like there's just nothing that I can contribute to that, that it doesn't already have. So I think if you want to get into industry, and in my consulting work, I see time and time again these people who want something new, and they say, I've discovered closure, and I want to bring it in, and we want to use it. And they pushed up to management, and they talk to their peers, and they won't shut up about it. But you know, that excitement spreads, and people want to experience that kind of excitement. And this is really how many, many projects I've seen have brought closure into the fold. And I think that if we want Racket to get in there, it has to elicit that same kind of excitement. I think as a language, it does. It totally does. But when confronted with this kind of thing, you know, a person might come to say, in the words of Halsman, as spoken by Captain Kirk, "I, stranger and afraid, in the world I've never been." That's the worst Captain Kirk impression ever. this is the idea, right? I mean, you come to Racket, whoa, okay, I want to do a data logging. Well, sorry. I want to do some lambda calculus. Well, there's like 17 there, and so you know this is a real thing. People are looking for a challenge, and I think it would behoove the Racket community to sort of provide guidance in that way, provide a way for people to really get in there and help, because there are people who are seeking it, and they'll come to you and they'll look for that. But there's a bigger problem with that, and a lot of times they'll come to this language, and although they are very excited, they'll come, and this is what they'll look like. They have these ideas in their head, and they come to Racket, it's very different. And again, I've seen this many times in religion, and people, you know, they have these notions of how software is done, and they're like grasping for those things, right? Like the person who's drowning, they have this familiarity of being on dry land, that they can just grab things and they can step on things, and that's what they try to do when they're sinking under the water. And this is what people are doing when they come to a language like closure. They're flailing about. So you know, those kinds of people, they need a helping hand. And so it's very important that you have people like that to sort of guide them. And I think Racket has a lot to say. And the people that I've met in the Racket community seem like these kind of people. Come here, let me show you something. And so, you know, that's important because, you know, it's not enough to just, the person's flailing, it's not enough for me to say, there's some documentation. So, let me illustrate this one. Who right now is thirsty? Raise your hand. I'm very thirsty. So, okay, there. Feel better now? There. Okay, everyone feels good. I feel horrible. They, you know, this is the kind of response that you definitely don't want to get. These people are thirsty for knowledge, and they want to learn, and this is not good enough. Likewise, they're hungry, and feeding them a menu is not going to do it. You know, these are the kind of people that can work as a bridge between where Racket's at, where they're working every day, and those people really need a way to traverse those. It's kind of evil-looking thing down here. That's industry and the bosses and like common programming practices, this and that principle and manifesto and all of that kind of stuff. Right? Because if they're not loaded up with the right kind of thinking, how are they ever going to be able to navigate this, this like marketing and language hype and endless Twitter streams of people hating on this and that. And they need a context for being able to filter that kind of stuff out. And if they're going to come to Racket, you have to facilitate it. And maybe one day you'll be walking in the woods after a long career dealing with Racket, working with Racket, and you've made a nice life for yourself. You're walking through the woods. Maybe you'll stop and say, it worked. Thank you. I can answer questions if anyone has any.
Yes.
Someone brought you water.
Oh, awesome. I have water, but this is the more immediate.
Nothing. We can talk after. Thank you. Oh, yes, Matthias.
What if we feel comfortable being a pixel?
I'm sorry?
What if we feel comfortable being one pixel in your pie chart?
I don't have much to say about that. I can't help you. I think that you can't force people to come to this. There has to be a willingness. And when you find the person who's willing to learn, then that's the person you have. Again, you have to help. Yes.
Just for fun, if you were to improvise the table of contents for maybe a follow-up book to The Joy of Closure, Joy of Racket, what would that look like?
Wow. Well, first of all, I would say written by Matthew Flapp. I watched him while I was giving this talk. He wrote four papers. So yeah, I would definitely defer that, and I would love to know, because I'm not going to write that book, but I would read it for sure. It would be an important book. Yes.
So it's been a decade since I worked in a skip, and when you said the word skip, I went, oh my god. So I'm astonished you got a jar, and you were doing closure. Were you able to do interactive things, or was it all like locked down, like what you could do 6 months in advance?
Yeah, so one thing that I was able to do is port our test suite onto Clojure. And so that was, the library was there. They couldn't stop me from using it. They had someone had signed it, right? If someone signs it, then it's written in stone. So when that happened, I ported the test suite over. We had this horrible test suite of Perl scripts. Just giant mess. And that showed some value, although I will honestly say I don't think that it, when I left, Clojure was continually used. But although I suspect that these test suites are still around. Yes, Will. Without going into too much detail, a skip is a restricted environment on a government site usually. And so they have these machines that are locked down. You go through these big gates and you close it right behind you. And so, if you're not clear, if you have to go to the bathroom, you have to get something to water. So it's like a miserable nightmare. It's like the worst environment that anyone could ever work in. There's a lot of people working in those environments, and they're not tweeting about it because they can't get to the outside world.
Yes. I think it's a pure compartmentalized information facility.
Okay. I didn't know that, but it sounds acronymy. Yes, Matt.
So in your picture of Racket is lush, it almost sounded like you were saying we need less libraries.
Well, no, I mean that ship has sailed.
We need more libraries. Like people say, can I use Racket to do X, Y, and Z? Well, you could do X, and there's kind of a prototype of Y, but now we don't have a library for Z. And they say, oh.
Yeah, so I know you're right, but
I really tried to convey a matter of perspective from an outsider's point of view.
So how do we let people know that there's actually lots of
I mean, we're kind of struggling with that now in closure. And if you come to a solution, please let me know. Because I saw it and Nico.
You talked a lot about sort of that having those folks to help bridge that gap and reach out and lend a hand to the drowning swimmer. Are there practices that you've seen or found to be particularly effective at that, that the Racket community can learn from?
Well, I think that, you know, let's say, you know, I'll use closure as a touchstone, but you know, there are people out there who are putting together closure bridge, they're reaching out to people and trying to teach and creating websites like foreclosure and all kinds of stuff that resources where people can go and without expending a lot of time and energy can really like get a feel for what it's like programming closure. And one of the most, closure is the first language I've ever come to where it was, there was really nothing there when I got there. There was an IRC channel and Rich was there and like 10 other people. And everyone was, and Rich was like, well, what do I name this function? And so, you know, we had this big book. That doesn't happen anymore, by the way. For good reason, because he'd be on there all the time. You shouldn't have called it transducers.
Yeah.
In any case, you know, it was an exciting time, but as it grew, you know, that sort of core idea that people were there to ask questions, and I haven't gone on the Racket RFC channel to validate that. I suspect that the environment is very similar. Someone goes on there to bug. What are you doing that for? You shouldn't even want to do that. So, but there's more. There's like this infrastructure out there of learning and teaching. And I think that would be. I think Racket could do it and would be a great thing to put that in. Dr. Racket is like near perfect for that. How do we get that from people's eyes? Yes.
So one thing Steve Wolfram said in his presentation, he had a part of their website that had subject areas full of examples of people who have done various things in Mathematica. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how effective that's been in popularizing Mathematica in their language, but you know, it seems to me maybe Racket needs more of that. It already has some, but maybe per subject area, so people just browsing the internet could say, hey, you know, I'm really into tennis or physics or whatever, and the community has contributed, hey, look what I've done.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know much about what he showed. Having no real tech. I've not used Wolfram language. And very minimal amount of mathematics. But I mean, it did look pretty impressive. It looked cool. Couldn't hurt, that's for sure. Yes?
It's a simpler community that is more like us. Our language clearly comes with anecdotes, stories, and various names for it. That lead people to sitting together. They don't know the program that way. They're looking to use R just enough for their university one task. That could be the model.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that, but that sounds very interesting.
Yeah, R is a discipline.
I'm familiar with R, but not that specific.
And then, you know, there's dot, graphics, you know, it has its gallery. Mm-hmm. And if you're trying to make a diagram and you don't really know how to start, you look at the gallery and I want something that's a bit like that. It gives you a starting point.
Yeah, I see this gallery just filled with fish. I have this vision. Yes?
I think I'm taking a different lesson from your art painting. I think you want the next thing that comes out of Racket. Given our naming division is still a conniver, schemer, racketeer, it literally has been mafia. And it has to be very small. I think your message really is small.
Well, it's you know, there are these conflicting viewpoints in industry. So you know, there's a lot of people that say they want that. They want to come to the language and everything's there. It's ready. It's waiting for them. And then there are some, and these are the people that I was sort of talking about. They're putting the word into the manager's ear. They're getting that adoption. You know, getting the thing in the door. You know, they want something else. Right? They're looking for something else. So you know, there's these conflicting things, and I don't know that the right answer is, you know, make it smaller, make it harder. I think that there's a balancing act there, and really like allowing people to discover what's there and what's needed is probably more important. Do I have
a right? So I think we should.
Yeah, okay.
And here's, please, a big round of applause. Focus. Next session starts at 10:50. Please come back in time. But there are refreshments in the back in Absalaga. Very interesting.
To Jason. But
if we don't show live,
well, I think you're probably right. I didn't get the talk on the
people ask me that all the time. I don't know, I just do it. Yeah.
I just do it.
How are you? I need to know some totally random question that nobody thought of. He could sit there and he could create the sequel and press enter, and the answer came back, and the general admiral said, thank you very much. And that was his pride and joy. And then we had 9/11, and then like the world changed. And all of a sudden, it was new leader. No more admiral sequels for us. And like, if you're going to do this, now you have to write the spec, you have to get the committees. It's a 6-month process. And I was in conference with him, and he said, you know what? It's time for me to retire. And I felt like, you know, we lose so much capability. I understand the information security stuff and all that, but you know, I There was nobody that we had who was like that guy, and his reaction to his mentality was, I need to retire.
Right.
And I was seeing that right and left. So when you said closure, I thought, oh my God, actually, you could go in there and you could start doing cool interactive stuff again that wasn't necessarily in the specs. You know, let people pick out a box. Now, how are you getting out again would be another question, but preserve it, but recreate it. Yeah, but anyway, it was a little bit of excitement. But I could see, like, having one jar and stuff, oh, I need this. The other story I have is, you know, there's high side, low side, you're never supposed to connect them. And before 9/11, I actually worked in an environment that if I had been the policy, I wanted to, so I put it, but we were told under no circumstances we could be trusted. But anyway, then after 9/11, this got all locked down. So anyway, there was this one system who was actually, it was made by a third party, but it was really NSA, and it allowed it to cause you to immediately connect high and low sides. And the box was governed by this very strict XML, which would do cleansing and figure out what was allowed. Not out. The problem was, you needed to change the XML. You had to go to the committee. The committee was 4 stars. They met once a month. They had a 3-month backlog. But if you had something that weren't working, yes, then you had to go above the committee. Guess who you had to go to? You had to go to the President of the United States. Can you imagine, you know, going to Barack Obama and saying, I need this XML change? It's never going to happen, you know? I'm so glad I'm not doing that stuff anymore. It's so insane.
Thankfully,
Oh, we never did all that up 10 years ago. That wasn't that hard. Yeah. Right, yeah, my boss is reasonable, you know, like he knows I'd like to do this and that. So he'll come and he'll say, you know, we're doing this next thing, but, you know, other people are using, so he says it in a nice way, you know, as opposed to, you will. Well, in college, this was a long time ago, I was talking about that reason. The one program in class that you already had is the little one playing at its classes where we built the console on 9/11 and we got a lot of it. So that was kind of my college. Okay.
Well, the reason
reason to have it on the web is if what you have on your site is this supercomputer that's going to run your Haskell faster than you could ever run it on your laptop, that would be a good reason to sign this thing.
This should last for 8 hours.
I know how to fly certain software.
Got a microphone cover?
Yes, there is.
Everybody, I was just chewed out by three people starting the session late, and so sit down.
My experiment worked.
It is a tremendous pleasure to introduce Matthew. Matthew and I go back about 20 years and a couple of months. But the day that really is absolutely totally memorable, I have to look this up, is the 26th of January 1995. That's when Racket was conceived. Matthew and I were in a room together.
Ask your parents, that's not how it works. Because I come home from a conference called Topic and decided that it was all useless. Not Topic, but another. The
topologies I was designing for function spaces. And I called a meeting that said, we need to build something. And the idea was created there, and neither of us knew it. And the gestation time of that baby was much shorter than the regular one. Around May, that was January, about May, I was version 40-something, maybe 20-something, but we counted in real numbers back then, in literal numbers, natural numbers. Who's doing that? It's a squirrel.
Stop that racket.
I don't know.
You have one microphone?
Yeah.
Can you mute it? Maybe
it's it. Is it good?
Better?
Yes.
It's my lamb.
It's a dragon. Oh, it's a dragon.
It's Matthew's fault. So, by the end of that summer, I was running the first Teach Student workshop. And Matthew had gobbled together with 40, I believe it was 14 different systems and languages. Is that the right number? And it was up and running by March. We demoed it in May. By September, I was teaching it. And that is how amazingly fast Matthew works. And because he works so fast, he also speaks that fast. So if you want to figure out what he's telling you now, pay close attention. All right?
My goal here today was not to give a technical talk. You'll see that I haven't entirely succeeded, but it starts off well. And I think there's a lot of people who don't, or any ideas?
You can have the microphone.
Yeah?
You can be other microphone.
Is this on?
No.
This one also squeaked. It's just me.
Turn the other one off.
It is off. It's muted. Is that the difference? Okay, hold the button down. Is this gonna work? Okay. We'll see. So, as I was saying, since there are people here who are new to Racket and may not know where it comes from, I'm going to start out trying to tell you, who probably built the tower and where the egg came from and all those things. As Matthias said, it started when we were in Houston. He was the professor, Robbie, and Sriram and I were the grad students. And Matthias had this idea for how to design programs, and Racket came out of that. And we graduated and spread out across the country. Meanwhile, there was this guy, Eli Barzilai, up in Cornell, who was doing a dissertation on something, but just started doing Racket all the time instead. He got involved pretty early. Then Matthias moved. So around 2000, this is kind of what the picture looked like. We had specialized at this point. So I work on the runtime system and the macro system. Robbie is the lead person responsible for Dr. Racket. So when you start up Dr. Racket, you're seeing his work, and also the contract systems, which you've already heard a bunch about that. Sriram has been mainly exploring ideas in the neighborhood of Racket and pushing in different directions there. Eli did a lot of things, a lot of libraries, but especially the infrastructure to get Racket out and all of the mailing list and everything that has to be done. And Matthias, still with ideas, and as will become clear from the slide as it gets crowded up there on the upper right, producing people, producing more racketeers. So this is, we spread out, we started teaching more students, so Ryan and Sam and Jay came along. Jay worked on the web server and lately on the new package system. Ryan did the macro stepper and more recently the database libraries, and Sam is of course TypeRacket. And they graduated and moved on, and there's another round of students. And other people that come in through sort of the academic system. And I've way oversimplified in my history, right? John and Kathy were around from almost the beginning in Houston and so on.
And this is, you know, still quite an oversimplification. This is a lot of the main people who are still active. When we fill in all the students who have come through and made, you know, many pieces of the painting, right? There's a lot of us here. And one thing we like to do to sort of recognize the work that they do, you know, they do some academic work and they publish papers and they get a dissertation, but for their contributions to Racket, we like to give out shares of the company. There is a PLT Design Incorporated. So that's what I'd like to do now. We have three of the people here. Neil Toronto, come on up, and Stephen Chang, and James Swain. So we have for them, certificates that look like this. It's a little piece of PLT Design. So, I thought I would have two hands for this. I think that's Stephen. So this is a very university academia dominated picture, right? That's part of where we come from. But it's not even close to the whole picture, right? And I've just put some dots on places where I know there are long-term projects, long-term contributors, and just the ones that I sort of knew off the top of my head. So this is, again, pretty incomplete. And a lot of people have been involved for a long time, but this year we have three new people that we'd like to appreciate and hand out shares of the company. Jan Axel Sergo in Denmark there. Greg Hendershot is here. So come on up, Greg. And Eric Dobson, who's not here also. So we'd like to thank those three people and have a similar certificate for Greg. Okay, so now you know a few of the faces. I'm sure you memorized that slide with four people before. That's one way of looking at Racket history. Here is a more development oriented what the picture looked like. So if we started in 95, then for a long time it was just about taking Scheme as this nice academic language and combining it with lots of libraries to make it practical. And then the module and the macro system came along when the language and the libraries grew to a certain point where we needed those things to manage it. And then in the mid-2000s was a bunch of work towards performance, right? Because we had enough things that it mattered at that point. And then we realized that we had this big pile of stuff that people didn't understand. So we had a real push on documentation and getting the word out. And of course, the name change to Racket came in inside somewhere there. And then most recently, the big push has been on packages and more generally sort of breaking Racket up instead of the big monolithic distribution into a lot more pieces. So not only making it easier for other people to contribute and sort of be at the same level that the built-in stuff is, but also breaking out the built-in stuff. And that's kind of a work in progress still. There's a lot now that you can use, but we still have some more work to break things up. So since that's kind of new, and since there's a facet of this that, as I've observed and talked to people, there's a certain part of it that people don't understand well yet, I'm going to just take some time to talk about packages. So if you want to know about packages, then you go to packagesracketlang.org, and you get this big list of things, and you have the package name there and the author's brief description. And then if there's documentation that can be built by the build system, then that gets linked in there too. So that's what it looks like to use it. You just go into Dr. Racket and say install a package, and you use that name in the first column or on the command line, echo package install. Right. So there's plenty of documentation on that or people who can help you. That's not so much the level I want to talk about. Let's back up a little bit and just talk about libraries. So suppose you have a fish library in some aquarium holder, or AQ for short. Okay. And of course you want to use this fish library in your program, which is somewhere else on your file system. So how do you refer from main to fish? Well, as long as that AQ folder is in collects, the designated main collection folder, okay, that's kind of the simplest way to do things, then you can just say AQ slash fish. That means the AQ collection and fish module, right? So how should we deal with packages? And one way is there is some web of packages out there. And so what you do is write something that refers to one of those packages out in the world. And that's a sensible way to do things, and that's kind of the way we did at first. You end up having to talk about sort of the author and the particular package and some versions, and then there's some version constraint matching that goes on. So this approach has some advantages in that it kind of is an obvious generalization. Just point to something out in the web. There's a sensible versioning notion built in, but there's some disadvantages too that have to do with how the package actually gets downloaded and installed, and whether you should be really referring to a specific instance of an interface that you mean, something like that. So another way to go about this is, of course, you have packages out there and you break out the installation step from the reference step. So the way it works is if you want the aquarium package, you install it using, as I just mentioned, Racket package install or in Dr. Racket. And what that does is just unpack everything into an aquarium folder, puts it under collects, and then once it's there, you refer to it just like you would any other. And in fact, this you don't really have to use Racket package install to install a package necessarily. You could use any of your tools that you have for taking archives and putting it locally into a folder. Maybe using Git, that's a common way to do things. If you had to put it under collects, that might be inconvenient. You want it to be in your own local directory somewhere. So then what you do is, however you ended up with an aquarium folder, you can say Racket package install aq slash, that makes it a directory path. And so then what happens is aq is kind of registered as a collection. Conceptually, it's put in the collections directory, but it's not actually moved. There's just kind of a link set up so that the module system knows where to find it. With me so far? All right. So I've oversimplified here a little bit, because this picture is more what happens if you say something like Racket package install and you put a URL there, because then you're referring to a specific, you know, pile of code that is pulled directly off and installed locally. But that's not what you usually do. What you usually do is Racket package install aquarium. So now I'm going to talk about catalogs, which is this intermediate step, which is a more interesting step than you might think offhand. So if you say Racket package install aq, then it goes and consults the catalog, and the catalog says aq currently means that zip file over there. And then, of course, the mapping in the catalog can change with the resolution of that. And that's straightforward, right? So you can imagine having multiple catalogs and consulting them in order until you find the first match. And that's exactly what happens. And in fact, when you download an installation for Racket, like 6.1, when you download the installer and run it, it is pre-configured with two paths. So first, it'll go look at the release-specific catalog. And then when it doesn't find there, then it'll fall back to packages racketlang.org. So what this lets us do is decide that certain packages really should be frozen with the version 6.1. And so when you ask for those packages, they're found in that first place, while at the same time, we can have new packages appear at packages racketlang.org. And it's not just a special thing for distributions, and this is kind of the point I wanted to get to, which is that you can make your own catalogs and have your own rules for how these package names that you request get translated into specific implementations. Particularly, you notice that when I say install aquarium, there's nothing about a version number there or a package author and so on. And instead, those kind of questions are deferred to the catalog. And if you want to take control over those questions, then what you do is you make your own catalog. And then we provide tools to make that easier. So there's Racket package catalog copy, which you point it at a catalog, and it just makes a shallow copy of that catalog. Just sort of photocopies the book. All the entries in the book are still pointing to what they were. So if you do that for packages, racketlang.org, for example, you take a snapshot of all the references to the packages, and that way if new packages are appearing and you're updating multiple machines, you can get a kind of consistent set of packages that way. That's just a shallow copy, and that's going to work for most things where packages are implemented, where the sources are GitHub repositories. where all the old versions are going to be there, so they won't disappear on you as they update. But if that's not good enough, then there's another tool called RACO Package Catalog Archive, which does this deeper copy. Copies the catalog, but also copies all the individual packages to one place there. And then you have to sort of taking a snapshot of the world. And that might be appropriate for some part of your development process or your testing and distribution process. And there's nothing special really about these RACO package commands. They're just sort of built-in convenience things, but there's a package library that gives you control over all the fine details. These catalogs can be implemented in a couple of ways. They can be a SQL database, a SQLite database. They can just be a directory with files in it, and there's APIs for manipulating those. So when it comes to questions like, how do I deal with, I have this kind of version constraint and I want these kinds of things and these kinds to not change, the answer is, make your own catalog and manipulate the mapping in the catalog to do those things. Any questions on this point? So I have one more step. But.
I noticed there were HTTP
packs. Yeah, the security is to be the next step. Mm-hmm. So we believe, Jay believes, he's designed this in such a way that we can add on, start using HTTPS and those kinds of things. I meant to go read the paper about package systems and security before today, and I forgot. But we'll go read that and find out what we're supposed to do. We're pretty sure we can layer something good on top of this. Okay. That's great. Yes?
When you do this catalog archive, is that sucking out every old version of every package?
No, it's just getting the current source.
Okay.
Yeah.
There are no old versions.
Yes, if you want the really clear official answer, you ask the designer, Jay. So there are no old versions. And I'm about to tell you why that's not true, but it's not his fault. Okay. So a catalog then just maps a package name, like a queue to a package source that is an actual implementation, HTTP, GitHub, something like that. Then, a GitHub reference can be like this, where there's sort of a second piece of information that is the commit, or it can have a hash something, where the something is a branch or a tag or something. So there's various ways, quite a few ways of representing a source, and it's all about sort of making the developer's view of things the same as the user's view. It's all directories that are plugged into the collection. Okay, so then suppose we're in this world where there's a 6.0 user and a 6.1 user and someone at some company that has very specific policies on the packages they want to use. They all have their own catalogs. That's great. They get control over that dimension of it. But now we have a new developer, or a developer with a new package. Right? Where do they put that so that everyone can use it? Because now there's all these other packages, all these other catalogs, right? Because maybe they want control over a subset of things, but still want to be able to see new packages as they come up. So part of the answer is each of these users may decide to consult multiple catalogs, where the second one is packages, Racket. So far, so good. So all users now see this new package, can conveniently access it. But this package relies on some 6.1 specific feature. Or to run right in 6.0, it needs something. So there's a story on dependencies that are checked when you install to make sure it's sane, and maybe this package just isn't sane for 6. So then what do you do? So this is kind of a classic extensibility problem where you have two different dimensions, you want to have different versions, but you also want to be able to add new packages. So what we've done for now is that packages actually can answer questions that combine a particular package name with a version. So this user's catalog consultation, when it asks, it'll say for 6.0, and this one will say for 6.1. And this author here in green can decide to point requests to different places. So I mention this again because this is something that's relevant to all of us making packages. Right? You want to make packages that sort of deal with different versioning constraints or different environment constraints. That's how you can do it. Whether this is a good idea or whether we should have separate catalogs, I think remains to be seen.
So that's sort of the point where we are now. And I, actually, right now, these requests are always version numbers, but I think there's no reason we could just generalize it to be more things wrong. So that's where we are. Any other questions on packages? Well, the whole point was just to say catalogs exist. If you have a question on how something might be done, the catalogs, catalog might be the answer. Yes?
Does that have the ESP numbers? I found it to be a case where Alex also pointed out that on macro packages, on the person in the local folder, it has to be underneath the specific version of Racket. No matter the creator thinks it's a little bit.
Okay, so the question is, you install 6.0, you do a bunch of packages, you upgrade to 6.1, and now you don't see your packages anymore. That was a specific choice we made. So all your 6.0 packages are still there. And actually, there's a migrate tool in Dr. Racket. So if you go into the GUI, there's a migrate to say, hey, I know about 6.0. You want me to reinstall those packages? It'll go fetch them again, but it can at least help you migrate. Other ways to do things have to do with giving a name to your installation, and then it'll go in a user-specific space, but under the name, so that when you upgrade, it'll rebuild them without downloading. So again, there's a bunch of little pieces. We tried to do the thing that was least dangerous for the typical user, and not mixing version numbers was the least versions was the least dangerous. But as you can imagine, there are 5 different levels of things you can configure. Any other questions?
I just wonder, what happens if two libraries run on the third library different version?
Yeah, okay.
Coupling Python is not dropped, but not by the solution.
Okay, so what if you have two libraries that depend on the third library and they have different requirements, different versions of that library? So we're taking a, so far we're not trying to solve that technically, we're trying to solve it socially. So if it's sort of both of those things, all those packages are supposed to be the latest package, then we hope that those authors have a conversation and make things all work in sync. When that's not an option, well, catalogs. If there's no possible combination of libraries that can work, like there just don't exist versions of the first two that work with the same, with a particular version of the second one, then something has to change. And I guess I'll throw in that another part of Jay's design here, I think, is aimed at empowering you to make those changes instead of being stuck on whoever maintained the library originally, so that things can be fixed through social processes. So there's not a crisp answer of the form, you can install both and it'll work. No. Well, so you can get, we considered it, yes. So the reason, I'll just say a little bit meta now. The reason there are so many package systems out there with slightly different trade-offs is the same reason there are so many different programming languages. It's really you choose one thing here and it has benefits or drawbacks over there. So we're all choosing different things, and that's part of the reason there are so many. So our particular choices don't try to deal with two different libraries, whether it's two different versions of a package that conflict, or two different packages that conflict, we just say, nope, go fix it.
Is it possible to under a given
collect? So the question is, under a collects directory, install two different versions. You know, if you change the packages so they define two different collection names, two different library paths, then you can do that. But the conflict that I was talking about is if they define the same collection and the same modules inside there, then the package system will say, no, this doesn't work. Yeah, we may well. So yes, the statement was in Python. That's what they did, and it caused lots of problems. And it's just hard to say that for sure we'll see the same thing because there are so many little details that are different, and they place you on slightly different points of the spectrum.
So I wonder how scalable the namespace is. So in the old system, you had a username and then the name. That is scalable in the sense that you don't have people with package names each other, namespace by name. But this new system, it doesn't look like it's namespace in that way. So is it like a first come, first serve system? How scalable is it?
So the question is, how scalable is it? Because the flat namespace with typically short names. This might be a problem, but again, that's where we opted for a social solution rather than a technical solution. Why there's a packages.racketlang.org. We know there are trade-offs there, but we're going to try this. Because we've seen the negative problems that happen with the other way of doing the more hierarchical thing. Have I said anything wrong so far, Jay?
You're preaching the true gospel.
All right. just for these multi-purpose catalogs like packages.lang.racketlang.org, that just means that the query comes in with a package name and something about your name. Okay, so that was about packages and sort of where we are. Now I'd like to sort of just say a little bit about what I think we're doing next and then open it up to more questions, particularly more general questions. So this is kind of the view from the bottom of what the world looks like. Now from me squashed under here, there's this giant runtime and then there's some libraries up there. And the runtime inside of it, you know, you saw it was colored in C code. This is still C, it's just C with the garbage collector. This is too much C. Obviously, we like Racket code a lot more. And so the current, you know, right now, like Monday, like tomorrow, you know, Monday's the day after tomorrow, is, you know, starting to rewrite the macro expander in Racket, of course, sort of lift that out of the core and make the core smaller. And then the compiler is either next or in parallel. And then there's all sorts of primitives that are built into the core that made sense as primitives when we just had an interpreter, but now that we have a compiler, then it certainly makes sense to pull those out. So that's, you know, somewhere between a week and a year or a decade's worth of work. If I had to guess, and I do have to guess, I'm going to say about a year. So that's what the kind of things that we expect to happen over the next year. And it's aimed not just at getting rid of the C code, but also making the whole runtime system more nimble or replaceable, right? That we can run on JavaScript or run on JVM or something like that. So the more we move out to Racket, the less we have to sort of replicate for different environments. I'll point out that we've already sort of shrank things with the package system, right? Now it's possible to download a small Racket, small and then 1/10 the size of the regular distribution, and you can get a Dr. Racket that's sort of in between the whole distribution and so on. So we're just sort of continuing that trend, pushing deeper and deeper down. Meanwhile, you know, there's typed Racket. Actually, some of the libraries are written in typed Racket, not Racket. So another thing that you'll see is that more and more of the libraries that are sort of close to the core or things that you build on will themselves be in typed Racket, push in that direction. In fact, with like the compiler and macro expander, obviously, typed languages are very good at helping you write compilers. So something like that should happen, but that you can see my picture doesn't work anymore. There's some sort of bootstrapping problem in there that we'll have to solve. So that might be the next year. I don't know. And when I sort of gave you this view, again, kind of from the bottom of what's happened over Racket, and I said there were these things that we concentrated on at different periods, but it's also cumulative, right? It's not that we just did this one thing and just the next thing. Every time we started focusing more on performance, then of course that carries through. And so we're just going to do all of these things still. And then the configurable one, I still think of this breaking pieces out of the runtime system as being in that configurable vein. Somewhere down the line, there will be something hashlang Racket 2, right? As Matthias alluded to. It was Matthias, right? I started talking about that before. Whether it would be called Racket 2, I don't know. What kinds of things will it have, I don't know exactly. We're pretty sure that we're going to make things more uniform and have more functional data structures built in, just copying what we learned from Clojure. We're pretty sure that... what else are we sure about? Parentheses? Yeah, I don't know. I'm sure about this as well. Despite what I may have said 3 years ago, don't go back and look. Yeah, so you can ask or suggest on that if you have particular things. So, you can tell I'm kind of running out of steam. I can always ask for more questions. If the questions get too hard, then I have my magic 8-ball to answer the questions for me. Any more questions?
Yeah, so for those of us who have...
Oh, wait, this is where you're supposed to use the microphone, right?
Yeah.
So I might as well just walk.
For those of us who have some favorite libraries that are still in Planet, is the plan to just continue with the automatic translation? Should we, you know, if nobody's working on those right now, should we go ahead and put those up and convert them to packages, or what would you suggest?
Yeah, great question. If you use a library that's in Planet, move it to the new package manager, sort of take control of it. And that'd be great to see that.
Neil's asking for.
Oh, yeah, but if it's someone who you know is reasonably active, you know, or even not, it's a good idea to ask. Any other questions?
You alluded to the Racket 2 thing in the future. Do you see that more as there are things that you now feel like were mistakes in the past that you want to correct, or is it more like we have these great new ideas that we want to push out?
I'd say it's a combination. We want to sort of do house cleaning. We know better ways to do certain things. Just to toss out a very concrete example, making structs opaque by default was the wrong choice. They should be transparent by default, maybe even prefab by default. And again, that's maybe something we learned through closure via Python and so on. So those kinds of changes or cleanups are correcting mistakes. But something that only sort of half fits in that category is we now know a lot more where we're going in a variety of pieces. We can make it more uniform. There's have things that, I don't know, I always worry about using the word orthogonal, but more orthogonal and more generic pieces. Yes?
Yeah, I would agree. Would this be a good, an appropriate time to ask about where you want to go as far as the growth of Racket?
So you mean how many users do we want to have, or something like
sure.
that? A few more users always helps, right? I'm aware that we don't necessarily want millions of users because we get boxed in various ways that way. On the other hand, one of my hopes is that we don't get boxed in the way some languages have, because we have this hashling mechanism. We can always introduce hashling back at 2, but still have hashling back at. Now there are some cases where that hasn't quite worked. The two are immutable pairs, and the recent change to undefined. But I think our experiences were kind of whittled in that. Undefined, we worried about undefined. Like, would people put up with this backward take a valuable change and no one objectives? And the world has worked just fine. It's just been a pure positive. So I'm optimistic, but we'll see how this plays out. So yeah, we want more.
This is maybe more general for Racket too. Brooks talked about the second system effect. Do you have any concerns about that?
No, because we're on system 6 or 7 or something. I mean, for me, my biggest second system was the GUI library. We rewrote it in Racket instead of C++, and we pulled it off. So I think we can do it. Any question? I like this walking around my kind of talk show face.
You mentioned a couple of examples about changing structs to transparent prefab, and then you were talking about the change to undefined. Could we just move Racket slowly, incompatible change by incompatible change, into the future?
As necessary, but I'm hoping that there's fewer and fewer incompatible changes. So they're more and more in the corner. So yeah, I think mostly what we do is we just define new languages while keeping new ones. And a lot of my open for end module MIST team programs still work and I still use them. And that doesn't hold for all of them, but it's something we keep in mind, balancing backward compatibility. Not only do we keep it in mind, balancing backward compatibility with future improvements, but we try to set it up so that we can do that anymore. We're doing on time.
Okay, so then I'm going to cut down the session. I have a little announcement. You have to stay seated, but we didn't break anyway. Does that make sense? We need to have a couple of minutes for me to check out this swirl in microphones, but we don't want to delay too much.
So just stay put and talk to neighbors, shake hands, you know, give a little hug there and there, love, peace, apple pie, let's thank Matthew.
I like the agenda, but I feel like I don't understand.
I'm not going to go to the hospital. But yeah, because I'm pretty sure.
It is unbelievable to introduce a person who had a dissertation, did a dissertation on general relativity. Of course, as folks would say, that fits to Racket, right? We're about as equally complex. All we need is Einstein to explain to the rest of the people. No, that's not true. So it's Dan came in from Melbourne, Australia today, this week, to talk about things he has done with Racket over the last many, many years. I Googled him. I think he's been with us since 2006-ish. The first reference I found, I must have written some essay on the philosophy of Dr. Racket. We commented on that. So it's 8 years now. And a couple of years ago, maybe a year ago, I got this email late in the evening, my startup has gone live. And it came in, and I clicked on the link. And it must have been the first one to visit the website. And I made a quip. And Dan's going to give us more and more quips. Thank you. Go for it.
Thanks, Matthias. It's an honor to be invited here and to meet so many people. I think I'm the most isolated person on Matthew's map. So thank you for that, and thank you for Racket.
There's also Hawaii.
Hawaii's only halfway to Australia. Very nice, though. So in my talk today, I hope to inspire you. Yes, I have had a colourful career. I left academia and thought, what skills do I have, and started programming professionally. Been back and forth a bit, done a fair bit of operations research. I think I missed the big data party by about 15 years too early for that. And nowadays, what I do is agile coaching. And I get remunerative contracts for that. And that allows me to also spend time doing more entrepreneurial things. But this all grows out of my teenage experience of writing programs and wanting to express myself. And I'm going to try and roll it all together today and hopefully inspire some of you. Hands up if you do some hobby programming. Just fun. I'm going to like this audience. Hands up if you work for a startup. Leave your hand up if you're one of the founders of the startup. Awesome. So this is number two for me, and that'll come into the story. And I will wax philosophical, but maybe not as much as Michael, I'm feeling so. I was trying to think what hooks all these things together, including life and work in Lispy languages. And so, in quasi-Maslowian terms, here is my theory, and it is mine, that once the basic needs are covered, most people want to do things they love and believe in, but they want their computers to work. But it's also been my observation that before you get to do in the pursuit of the things that you love and believe in, often there are tedious and time-consuming hoops to jump through. So my approach differs somewhat to the underpants-obsessed novice. Okay, so here's my meta plan. You need to find something that people love and believe in or are obligated to do. Find the bad bits and crush them. That's the opportunity. Now, what I would like you to think about is that, like the gnomes say, success means profit, but success to me mean many things. It might mean the dream of the startup. It might mean of the profitable startup. It might mean fame. It could be being invited to give a talk on the other side of the world. It could mean making discoveries, expressing yourself artistically, or just making a difference. So here's the plan for the talk today. And hands up if you know what a patchwork quilt is. This is not a typical patchwork quilt. The Amish didn't traditionally make them like this. So rather than go into more in detail, I'm going to show you one of the videos my wife made to explain what we do. Now, I'm not quite sure how sound's going to go, so let's just see. Right. I can just see something which had a place in you. There it is.
Hi, my name is Andy and I live with my family in Melbourne, Australia. I love making quilts. Recently, I have become fascinated by pixelated images in quilts. But I don't want to spend hours at the computer trying to work out pixelation, colours, and fabric images. UPatch is my solution. Upload your image and UPatch does the hard work for you. Whether you are a beginner or expert quilter, whether you prefer a photorealistic or pop art style, you can turn any image into an easy to follow pattern. All the information you need to create a unique pixelated quilt. Here are some pixel quilts that I've made using UPatch. So come and join me and have a play. What will you patch?
Okay, get it? that's what it is. So I'm not here to get to sell patents, but to dive into the technical backstory. And I hope that you will see analogies. And I also want to meet as many people as possible and have a chat about what we're doing as well. So how did this come about? I was between paid employment opportunities. I was playing around with Racket. It's been a couple of years since I did the last startup, and I saw my wife trying to turn this picture of Groucho using applications not suited into a design. And I said, how long is that going to take? And she said, oh, maybe about 10 hours. And I stressed, that's not an enjoyable experience, and it's an error-prone experience. And I said, ooh, that doesn't look like a job for a human. Tell you what, explain to me slowly and carefully the process, and I shall write your program. So, took me a little bit more than 10 hours, not much, but it was 10 hours of fun, whereas it would have been 10 hours of tedium. And at the end, I was able to click a button, and this is what it did. So for the hack, start with an image, reduce the spatial resolution, that's easy. Pick out the colours, there's only 5 colours in there, that's easy. Recolour them to match the colour scheme of our kitchen. Not too hard. The fun bit is writing the algorithm to aggregate the matching squares into bigger pieces, constrained also by the actual physical act of making it. So there's a computer scientist or mathematician, you might see additional opportunities for aggregation, but there's a very physical recursive process to build it back up, and so that influences it as well. Now, what was useful for me was the Dr. Racket graphical REPL, and I found this thing called the image library, which is very nice. Who's responsible for the image library?
Robbie.
Thank you, Robbie. Now, I assume you didn't have this application in mind.
No.
And so, to me, a hallmark of good design is you set out to do something, I'm guessing, making graphic programming accessible to students. Yeah. When you do a really good design, you'll find that you can go to a nearby domain and you're already halfway there because the abstractions are good abstractions, and that's what I found. Normally, in graphics programming, of course, the main metaphor is painting pixels on a canvas. But in patchwork quilting, when you put the quilt together, you take two pieces of fabric and you sew them along a seam, and they come together. And things like the side and above placed me much closer conceptually to the domain I was working in. So I was able to do something quite nice in a weekend. Press the button, out comes the result. This is how much fabric to buy. Now, when you design a quilt by hand, you might order not enough or too much, so either a waste of money or you've got to go back to the shop, and that can be a long way away when you're in Australia and the shop is in America. we don't really have overnight delivery. And of course, I will print out what to cut, how many squares and rectangles. But this is the fun bit. Producing essentially engineering diagrams. So we've done this computer aided design. And here's my beautiful wife again, and the result. So that's the hack. That's fine. As she was happily sewing away, doing the fun bit, I asked her, would anybody else be interested in this kind of thing? And she said, yeah, pixel quilts are trendy, but you know, not many people are doing them because of the tedium and the difficulty and things like that. Sheldon had about 7,000 pieces. And I had been thinking about doing another startup. I was sort of in recovery from a failed one. Do the words lean startup mean anything people hear? Yeah. So that was what I'd read about toward the end of the previous one where we'd done it the bad old one. And I thought, wouldn't it be nice to have another go, and this time it would be mine, or I would be one of them. Okay, so Steve Blank's definition is, a startup is an organization formed to search for a repeatable and scalable business model, as distinct from an established business which executes. Now, my wife said, is there enough racket in this talk? And yesterday it occurred to me I could put some in. So hashlang lean startup. I didn't put it, it hasn't yet been ported to type for racket. But, and this is the only code you'll find in it, and I had some help with a code review yesterday, so thank you, because it doesn't compile yet. But here's the idea, and the people who know about startups perhaps can help me out with this. So search, we know about search in computing. Okay, so there's more to it. If you're considering this kind of thing, please go and read the literature and whatever. But the idea is that we're trying to search for something called product market fit. So you come up with a product, you have start off with a minimal viable product, because this stuff is just scientific method. You form a hypothesis, you test the hypothesis, and then you learn something, and then you make a new hypothesis, and you iterate, so that's your search. So the idea of having a minimum viable product is to start with something small, because that's going to be cheaper and faster to build, and you also choose an initial market. Maybe they're going to match, maybe not, but fantasy is that they'll match. Probably you're going to have to go through a second, third, fourth iteration. You need some resources, in my case, time of work, and you start with high morale and high hopes. So, help me out here. So if you achieve product market fit, what does that mean? Yeah, yeah. Okay, we've got a scalable business where we can go and do something. Or if it's a lifestyle business, we just sit back and passive revenue rolls in. What do you do if you're low on resources? By the way, there's no uniquely correct answer here. This isn't a completely solved problem.
Either use fewer resources or get more.
Yes, or...
Use Racket,
yes.
So as you have more efficiently by using Racket.
Yes, by using Racket, or at my previous one, you might downsize rather radically as part of the death spiral. If the product and market, you may not know whether there's a problem is with the product or with the market, what do you do?
Change one of them.
You pivot is the lingo. But yeah, you change. That's going to take you into your next iteration. What if your morale is low?
Use Racket.
So without choices, we're pretty much invincible because we started using Racket and basically got infinite resources because we don't spend money except for and otherwise, what do? You iterate. You make little tweaks based on what information or feedback you have. So that's kind of the idea. There's more to it than that. But you have a transferable understanding. Oh yeah, now this one. So thank you, Dan Friedman. Question mark technique. I should point out the comp is not. This is what I also learned. It's not a top to bottom thing, right? It's more like you sort of look at these issues and you may act. You might if you're really low on morale, but other things are going well. You've got to act on that rather than. Leave it because the things above. So this isn't a strict ordering. It's more of maybe it's a random, or actually it means using your brain. Okay. So in our case, the initial markup, we could have done different things, but we took my wife as being representative. So into patchwork quilters. We wanted a minimal product, something we could iterate on and which we could build quite quickly and test out. So here's the pitch for the product. You upload an image, or you take one from the internet, and please don't violate copyright, but we worried a lot about this, but we're not successful enough that it's a problem yet. You can pixelate and edit for free. I've heard that you don't want to mess with Mickey Mouse, but to your heart's content. And when you've got an image that you're happy with, then you can pay us $9.50 US if there isn't a sale on, and we will send you a customized PDF. Now that, I'll just mention, that price was determined by mainly extrinsic factors. You buy a geometric design PDF for a similar amount, so we settle. You need a team unless you can do everything yourself, so maybe Matthew Lapp could do a startup by himself, but mere humans. We had two already. But I don't know so much about web stuff, and I've worked with John Barham, a Canadian. Apparently his ancestors did, but he would never have guessed he'd end up doing this. And he'd done some similar, you could see he'd just done something where you could upload your HDR images and to the cloud, and it would combine them beautifully, and you pay a couple of dollars and send it back. And if I stood back and squinted, I could say that's similar to the business model we're considering. And so we brought John on board, so I didn't have to learn everything. So that was great. So, our target market, mainly, there's about 1 million, we think, women, a few hundred men maybe, doing generally older age group. My wife is that they're probably, there are these young and funky ones, and we're middle-aged. So we had to make it easy to learn and use. And there's this trade-off. You can make it really photorealistic, but we wanted to bring it to the masses and to convey how hard or easy it is to make a particular design. So we want to give them the control. And so we applied a user-centered design approach. And product development, I'll just mention a couple of things. Groucho had 5 colors. If you upload an arbitrary image, it's going to have an arbitrary number of colours. Each colour, that's a different kind of fabric, so you want to take it down to a handful. So interestingly, I started using clustering algorithms and mathematical things, and then I asked my wife, is there a particular palette I should be targeting? And she said, yes, there is this range of colors. So I reformulated it as a range of fabrics. I had to reformulate it as a matching problem. So that's one of the things. When you're not doing general stuff, when you're doing particular stuff, and you've got good insight into the domain, you can often do simpler approaches. We need a PDF generation to have a look. What was there? I said, there's this thing called Scribble. Thank you, Matthew. That worked for us. And I was prepared to be quite pragmatic. As far as I was concerned, Racket was fantastic for the R&D. But if we had to translate into other things, the production, I was quite happy to do that. I've done that kind of thing before. But Racket is still there at the back end, doing the image processing, producing the PDFs. I didn't feel comfortable forcing John to learn other stuff, especially when he used these other technologies successfully, which was half the reason I brought him in to our group. So there was the question of integration of other technology, which proved good. So we started, and this was when I made the announcement which Matthias described on the list, with a teaser site. So we didn't have a lot of editing, but we did have a logo, again made in Racket. And so we put up a very simple site where a user could come, register their name and email, answer a short questionnaire with questions about why you're interested in pixel building, what will you do given this facility, illustrating the process, and we would send them the free design for Marilyn over there. And via social media, my wife posted, had a bit of reputation in quilting circles as a blogger. She put this up, hey, come and register for our new startup, get a free pattern, and got a few hundred sign-ups pretty much like that, which encouraged us. And interestingly, some people didn't download Marilyn, and they didn't like the design. And we inquired with one or two of them who were new, and they said, oh, no, I don't like the design, but I want to know when your product's available. So I would have liked to have done a small iteration where we say, send us your pictures or the things you'd like to turn into a quilt and we'll do it, because then I didn't have to write the front end to do all the editing and we kind of had everything on the PC. And I was outvoted. So at the start of a couple of months of work, and at the start of this year we launched. So the way the whole tech stack works is the front end is just HTML, JavaScript, drag, query, bootstrap, so it's kind of works on your phone or your tablet. The middle layer is Python, Nginx, Django, Mezzanine CMS, another Australian invention from Sydney, however, so I can't be too boozed. it's like only two cities you need to care about in Australia. It's lots more. The back end, as I said, is the deep back end that does all the good stuff is Racket. And the way it all talks together, I'm told, how it, what is it? I don't really know about this stuff. It is a quasi, I don't know what the quasi means, it's a quasi microservices architecture. And what that means to me is we've got well-defined interfaces using JSON. And that's worked quite nicely for us. So I'll quickly step you through how it works if you haven't had a play. So step one, upload your image and you can crop it. You can choose the aspect ratio of the quilt. We've kept it nice and simple. It can be square, it can be portrait, or it can be landscape. This is the main step. And this is where you get to play, because if once we've taken away the tedium, you can get immediate response. You can see what happens when you change the level of detail from lower to higher resolution, or the number of colors, 2 to 15, that the limits were proposed. Quilt size just changes how much fabric you've got to order. And you can sort of compare it with the original cropped image to see it, if it's a representation. You might want to be photorealistic, you might want to do stylized, like two colors or a pop arty. My wife likes the pop art style. And this is my attempt to convey the complexity. How long will it take to make the quilt? Because if it's going to, it's easy to wind up all the colors, and some of our users do this, and wind up the level of detail to get a really photorealistic thing, and then they may not be able to make it. And it will take a long time, and then they won't be a fast, they won't be coming back for another one in a long time, which is bad for us. And they won't be posting it on Instagram and Pinterest and saying, look what I made with UPatch. Unfortunately, this doesn't guarantee that they'll do the right thing. And I'll come back to that. So we put them in control. The computer's generating these designs. And then we were able to make some very specific editors. This is the one where you can go all pop art and change the colors. And the colors are, you know, not HTML colors, but they're actually fabric colors from a specific. And we've included some pixel editing. So one thing that can happen is that the highlights, like lips and eyes, go. In this case, I added a color, a bit of orange, and put back in the bubble loop that my daughter's using to blow the bubbles. Give the quilt a name, pay some money, and we'll send you PDF. You get emailed a PDF. So we're actually in the ebook publishing business, and our median number of readers per book is one. We've got some other patterns for sale, and they may sell. So how do I get 19 pages? Well, I can, you know, generate a lot of pages computationally. There's some pretty pictures. There's the shopping list. There's what to cut. There's a tutorial of how to assemble it, what you'd expect to get in a pattern. And then there's the quilting by numbers. And you get to do these fun little things, like I need lines, and they've got a contrast, and I don't know what colors people have chosen. So that's a little algorithm to invent. Or I wasn't convinced that my heuristic was correct for how much fabric to buy. So I visualized it and I said to my wife, would that be a good feature? No one does this. They don't done this kind of thing with computers. And she said, no, and it's ridiculous. And then I showed her and she said, that would be really cool. And people love it. So it's this intersection. Like, I learned stuff from her about what the problem really was. But with my knowledge of maths and computing, you know, you've got this. This is what I think they meant about cross-disciplinary research. Okay. So, startup people, you all recognize this picture? Yeah. Okay. So this is where your customers or users, depending what is where they live. The innovators, the people who hear about what you're doing and just glom onto it almost immediately. They're actively looking. Early adopters are the, you know, open-minded people who will come on quite easily. We got these guys immediately, got some of those. But most people in the early majority, they need social proof. And there's the thesis of Jeffrey Moore is that in tech adoption of something new, and this is new, there's this big scary chasm to cross. The late majority will go once the early majority comes along and laggards. Sorry about that. Okay. So social proof. People start making stuff. So this is enormously gratifying. As predicted by our questionnaire, children, pets. Interestingly, I thought cats would be more popular than dogs in being on the internet. But our questionnaire revealed otherwise, then there's research to be done. Pop culture, geek culture, and you've heard how much that Microsoft has bought Minecraft. Yes, for $2.5 billion. We will not be that successful. I will eat all my clothing in. So what else? Yeah, we don't pay for AdWords. We do stuff on social media, so we want people to write about us. They do to a certain extent. And we've got it to magazines. The story is interesting. It's something new in the quilting world. We'll sometimes do a pattern giveaway. So these are the kind of simpler patterns that people can make rather than overambitious ones. And excitingly, this hasn't quite come out yet, but so we chose a particular range of fabrics that they love us because we're basically advertising their fabrics. There's block fabrics. And they came to us a few weeks ago and said, we've got a new range of fabrics inspired by Vincent, the organizer of this conference. No, Vincent van Gogh. And could you do a design which features the new range? So normally we use those fabrics, but I did a bit of post-processing and they'll be launching it like about now. I think it was supposed to be a step, but we haven't seen it from that. And they'll direct people to our site where they can sign up and get a free fabric, a free design of Vincent featuring these non-block fabrics. So that's kind of cool. One of the things that you're supposed to do is concentrate in the lean startup vernacular is concentrate on really making your early adopters happy, because they are going to be the missionaries, if you like, who give you the good word of mouth. So when you really personalize support, like I'll just explain, people do just turn all the dials up and download a pattern. And so we see what everyone buys, and if they look overcomplicated or they've struggled with it, my wife will quickly redo it and send them a nice letter explaining how she did it. Here's a free pattern, so you've got the choice, and here are the tutorials that you should have, which you can please go and do so that you can do this for yourself next time. And often we get nice responses and sometimes good insights into where they struggle. And we send out newsletters showing what I've done. We'll do our first craft show in Australia next month, and I'll be back in the US with my wife in Austin, Texas, at the biggest quilt show in the world. So I'm hoping to have some other experimental things to try out there while we raise consciousness. But what's nice is from here we get to iterate, especially since I'm now not working full-time for a little while. And we have a name in the tech craft area if we want to try other ideas. So we can pivot not out of panic, but out of the desire to do better when we come up with other ideas. Okay. So, what do I love and believe in? Well, obviously, problem solving, creative programming, and making a difference in people's lives. And I deserve good tools as well, or even great tools, which brings me to Racket. So for me, low barrier to entry was important. So I discovered Racket when I was reading CP and I was looking for a scheme, it was Dr. Scheme, and, to learn it, and Racket just opened up and worked. Sorry about this, I tried to get closure to work and it was harder, but, you know, and I didn't have Emacs at that time, and so yeah. So the thing just being able to download and stuff works is fantastic. But what drew me to the Lisps was this desire to be able to ultimately express myself in the cleanest possible abstractions, and for that you need that macro or whatever you're allowed to call it, capabilities. I'm not there yet, but I, you know, use a bit, and it's nice that I can go in whatever directions that I choose. Now, in terms of UPatch, what were the winners? So the Dr. Racket graphical REPL thing, it's not just batteries included, it's like jetpacks included. I've mentioned the image scribble has been fantastic. The community is so nice and intelligent and responsive. And R&D to production proved possible. It was a bit slow at first, the execution of the core loop. So I did a bit of timing, learned about unsafe operations. Startup time was a bit slow. It wasn't like the JVM, but it wanted faster. So I built the Grouchify server. So I've got a little server at the back end where it just runs there and John's code calls it and all works nice and fast. So it's been great. So coming back to the original theme, I like doing creative programming, and not everyone raised their hands. I think now is a great time. I mean, I probably correspond to that autodidact category when I start out. But now, if you do something, you can put it up on GitHub. And I think the first one which got any response that I did was my 2048 implementation. So sorry for the time wasting. But I got a couple of pull requests from Greg and from John Clements, so that was a buzz. I didn't really get it until that happened. In academia, there are speak to the core Racket team about that. I'm not the person to ask. Regular job for me, I've had mixed experiences. That's kind of why I do the agile stuff, so people don't tell me to do stupid things in stupid languages. But I'm here to talk about startups. So why do it? It's like this fantastic adventure. You get to make the choices. There's the lure of fame and fortune happened yet. Why not? It is stressful. The flip side is that you're responsible for those choices. And you need to have the time and resources to do it. I'm not saying that you shouldn't take funding. I've worked at a funded startup before. But I do like owning intellectual property. I'm not sure why. But if you do it yourself, it's kind of DIY. You learn about things, you find that, well, compared to relativity or racket research, doing things like registering a company, it's different, it's out of your comfort zone, but hey, it's not that hard. You can do it. And you can transfer those skills, the scientific method stuff, to business development, which I highly recommend the lean and agile stuff. And you can, as Paul Graham said, you can choose whatever you like, some sort of list, maybe even Racket. So that's my story. I hope it resonated with you. Thank you again for inviting me and for Racket. And time permitting, I would love to answer any questions or just support afterwards.
Yes.
What the hell is it? Not for this one. Okay.
So, Tom. Just for Tom.
I want to get a quilt that looks like this. And I want to get a quilt that has the pictures of the people who contributed to Racket.
Okay. So, now, interestingly, one person who responded suggested a John McCarthy quilt. And okay. So one possible pivot. So the way to do it, also lots of faces don't necessarily work that well, but I would encourage you to go and have a play. Right? Do you know, if you know someone who's into quilting, that would be good because that's what we're targeting. We have this thing called the China option where we actually sell the quilt, but we're not up to that kind of.
I know a lot of Amish.
So yeah, it's doable.
Is that maybe one more real quick question, and then we'll go for lunch.
Thank you. I actually was curious about the China option. I know that like computers can run things like embroidery machines. I didn't know if there's something similar for quilting where you could do something insanely complex and not depend on humans.
Okay. Thank you, Matthew. Digress on this. So last time I haven't been in America for 20 years. I was here with the family because we have family in Los Angeles, a little place called Beverly Hills, and there was a family wedding. And what I didn't know was, like, we came just in time for the wedding, and then we had like a trip of a lifetime holiday. But the groom, now part of our family, was from the East Coast, and it turns out he was a robotics engineer working at JPL. And if I'd come a day earlier, I could have had a tour with his folks. So he asked the question, of course, you're going to make these books with robots. And I said, look, let me do the literature review. And it turns out it's quite hard because of the stretchiness of the fabric, but it's an area. There's probably something there. You probably don't have to totally automate it because there's people trying to, you know, put the sweatshops out of business, which would be quite a change. But we haven't gone there yet.
Racket robots.
So, you know, if you want... But
isn't it the case that they want to do it, feeling close to the person that they're building the build for and so forth?
And that's the market, that we've gone for initially. But, you know, and there's other possibilities. We could try and become an enabler so that... because I reckon if you could deliver this kind of stuff at a reasonable price, then Comic-Con, people would want all their geeky quilts. It's the economic side. So yes, Matthias.
Do you think that Racket has the abstraction power to create a store where you can buy a craft site? And you have found one, you're going to give another example. You said you're going to do another craft, apparently your wife is a crafty person.
She's pretty obsessed with
it. But if you have two, you can extract over it, and then just offer a way for people to buy and make your own craft website. I have done a craft.
I think the answer is maybe, like a lot of people said, what about... you know, what about knitting? What about needlework? Mosaics, etc. I've got squares and rectangles in there. Quilts have triangles and things like that. So there are possibilities. I mean, I think you can model all that stuff, how different the domains are, I'm not sure. I think it's a question for lunch or...
That's actually okay.
Speaking of which, yes, so let's, another hand of applause for you. So now it's time for lunch, so we have about an hour and a half, so we should reconvene at 1:40 for the next session.
Is this room going to be locked?
I don't know. I wouldn't bet on it, so if you have something that you would prefer not to have stolen, I would take it with me if I were you. So as far as lunch options go, so you're on your own, four groups spread out, as long as you come back in time. The food court in the Union Station should be open today. There's an Irish club next door as well, further down Market of London West. And there's probably other various places that you've discovered during the strange loop, so do whatever you want, please come back in time. Thank you.
Thank you.